I like to start this presentation before handing over to Rainer and Frank Kühn. And yeah, let's just briefly introduce ourselves. All the three of us already drive the development of Focus Build since years. And we now additionally support the cloud ALM development in that way. So that we share the gained experience, how to support more complex projects. So we help to define the concept, how to seamlessly run through an end-to-end process with cloud ALM. So really helping to define how this end-to-end process can be executed with the current functionality and what's needed for the further development. So, but before we come to the content, I'd like to make you aware of this usual disclaimer, what we have. So, you see, as we already inform you of one or other functionality which is not yet published, please note that this information in this presentation is confidential, proprietary to SAP. And some functionality, Sarah, may be changed by SAP later on. And if you communicate via social media, then please use the hashtag ALM Summit. So as well, mentioned in other sessions beforehand. And of course, in case of questions, as George already said, please use the Q&A functionality in Zoom. And if we can't cover all the questions, so then please join the Meet the Expert session for SAP Solution Manager and Focus Build this afternoon. So don't get confused that SAP Cloud ALM is not mentioned in the title. It's still the right session. Okay, coming to the agenda of this session. So in the introduction, I briefly explain which cloud ALM use case is covered in this session, because there are several others which can be supported. Then in the main part, Rainer is conceptually explaining the cloud end-to-end process, and then in addition gives as well a demo how this is looking like today. And as a conclusion of this session, then Frank will present the other use cases which can be supported by cloud ALM. So let's start the introduction. So I assume that everybody of you understood from the previous session that SubCloud ALM for implementation supports implementation projects with a standardized toolset which can be used out of the box and is operated by SAP. So super easy to operate. So everything you need is available right from the beginning, and you just need to know how to best use the functionality for your type of project. On the next slide, then, I just briefly show you the typical use case, or the first cloud ALM use case was obviously the most simple one. So to support projects for the public cloud, and which are rather simple fit to standard projects, where the focus lies mainly on tailoring the scope of the project, decide which processes to implement, for instance, and to assign predefined to the tasks to the team members. In the next slide here, now we see that this is not the only use case we support. Of course, we started last year with a predefined content for the S4HANA public cloud implementations. And we have already a lot of functionality for this use case. And you've seen probably the one or other session of our successful customer projects. And second, that's not all. As announced on Tuesday already, we plan to offer additional content this year already, for instance, for SuccessFactors and Ariba. So we can efficiently support those types of projects as well. And this is now focus of this session. What we also do is that we now support the implementation of S4HANA Private Cloud Edition. So you see the hand wall, all those points. There is already a lot of needed functionality available. But the question now is how to use it in this context of a private cloud implementation project. And because this use case is now more customer specific and more complex, there is, of course, much more focus on requirement maintenance, agile development with user stories and deployment orchestration. And of course, there's a higher need of analytics and traceability. And how all of this already works together right now already in SubCloud Elim is now explained and demoed by Rainer.
Yeah, thanks, Henrik. So coming to the next section. So what Henrik mentioned is that so far the focus of Cloud ALM for implementation was more content driven, and with the content it was easily possible to implement public cloud solutions just using the content. But many customers want to make innovation on top of the SAP standard. Therefore, they also choose the SAP HANA Private Cloud Edition. And therefore, they want to innovate on top of these standard processes. And therefore, it was required to make a kind of requirement to deploy process, like it was developed in Focus Build, but also within Cloud ALM for implementation. And as mentioned, the typical use case, and also in this use case, we start with the content. That means we have the best practice processes. And together with the best practice processes, we have also the SAP Activate methodologies. And here we can completely use the provided task templates that are built for each type of implementation. And also what we have since several months is the central business configuration integration into Cloud ALM, where we also can hand over configuration items into tasks in Cloud ALM. And this could be used then to drive customer or partner own innovation on top. That means typically we start then addressing business needs, additional business needs with requirements. We decompose those requirements within the project into user stories, and these user stories then are realized by developers, consultants for configuration items. But in parallel, we can also work on the Activate tasks and the central business configuration tasks that are coming from outside, but can be used inside the project. On top of that, we can also create project tasks that is typically used for clarification needs if something is not understood and someone needs to take care on not things that need to be developed or customized in the solution, but need to be done in a more organizational way. And of course, we need to test what has been built via user stories. And of course, it must be deployed. And here we have a quite new baby in our solution that is called Feature. And that is possible, with that is possible to all manage the deployments, either to a test system, a QAS system, and later on to the production system. And what is the glue of this end-to-end process is the whole analytics and traceability features that we have in Cloud ALM, because that allows us to see dependencies between processes, requirements, related user stories, and also it's used to trigger actions, what is required for a certain point of time. And I will show that later on also in a demo. Before doing that, we'll go in a more detailed view on an end-to-end process, how it could be done for a requirement-driven implementation. So it starts with selecting a best practice process, as we have learned yesterday from Wolf. On top of that, there will be soon a solution also to model your own processes on top of the standard best practice, so you could enhance that. Also, this could be selected as a starting point, and then you will create a requirement for that, addressing your business need. And then it will be used, it could be used to approve. So it's an optional step, but some customers say, okay, before we go into implementation, we want to go through all the requirements and say, okay, which one are relevant? Maybe some are even redundant, so there are duplicates and so on, and therefore you could adjust this. And later on, if you want to really go into implementation, then you can approve that and create then user stories for these. That means you decompose the requirements. So typically you have at least one user story per requirement, but it could also be several user stories if you want to distribute the work to several teams. And optionally, there is also a possibility to create subtasks for user stories to distribute even the work to single developers, but that is also optional. Then you process the user story. That means processing a user story means you are developing, you're providing the code, you're doing a configuration, and also doing the unit test. That means quality assurance on the user story level is an implicit step within a typical Scrum team. And finally, you complete the user story, and this is done at the end of a sprint, typically with a show and tell session and approving that the user story has been completed. In parallel, tests need to be prepared. That is either acceptance test based on the requirement directly, or it could be a functional integration test that collects several entries of a process. And that is a test preparation. And also, as mentioned in the slide before, you can use a template task. On top of that, you can create your own project tasks that are required. And you can create out of a requirement, you can also create additional tasks that belongs to the scope of a requirement. And in future, we also want to provide a feature that it's possible to assign existing tasks, either coming from the template or that has been created in parallel, to assign that to a requirement to be also part of the traceability for that requirement. And also these tasks could be completed. And then we need to take care about deployment. That means what has been built in a user story is typically captured in a transport that is assigned to that feature. And if the testing is done, of course, for the testing, you need to deploy the coding or the customizing into the QAS in order to be able to execute the acceptance test or the functional integration test. Then, if that was successful, you could deploy the code to the production and you can confirm the requirement that is completed. Now we go to a demo showing the first three steps. So typically when we start in Cloud ALM for implementation, we go to the overview page, because there we typically see what is required. And here I have prepared a project and the scope that I have defined, especially for this demo. With the scope, you can bundle a collection of processes that are part of that scope, and the scope could be used to distribute different kinds of activities to different teams. Typically, you can use LOBs like logistics, finance, and so on to define the scope. And here I have defined the scope for our demo. And I see here there is a number of processes that has been assigned to that scope. That's four processes. And if I click here, I directly see my four processes. And for one of these processes, I want to create a requirement because something needs to be added on top of that standard process. So it's a iterated customer returns process. So if you click on that, you will see the solution value flow. And if you want to see details of that process, you go to the solution process flow. You can zoom in to find all the process steps or activities that is part of the process. And typically this activity is done in a fit to standard workshop. And then you go through the process, check maybe even with a sandbox system if the standard process is covering the business needs. And if not, then you are able to create a requirement. In this example, we create a requirement for the activity perform picking. So I select that process activity and go here on the right side to the create requirement dialog. Then the title is provided automatically. I can override it, and then I should be address a meaningful description here in order to let the project team know what is really required. This is just an easy example, but typically it would be more meaningful like this example. And I just save it. And I see here now, I have here on the right side, I see that there is a requirement attached to that process. And now I switch to the other role that needs to approve that requirement. And for the approval, I can go to the analytics overview. And here in the analytics overview, you see several tiles or cards that could be used either for test execution analysis, task trend analysis, but also what is most interesting for us, requirements traceability, process traceability. And in future, we hopefully see also there a card for feature traceability. And that could be used then to support our process for the end-to-end implementation. In the process traceability, then I see my four processes that are part of my scope. And I see I have one requirement created that is still in status in specification. And now I can have a deeper look on that requirement. I will check if we have redundancies. I can check if the effort and the value ratio is quite sufficient to make it part of my project. And doing that, I go in here and just click on approve. And as approve is an additional attribute of a requirement, we also can set the status of the requirement from in specification to in realization. As soon as it's decided, though, this requirement will be realized, it could make sense to already set the status to in realization. And of course, if I want to make it also transparent for the process, I can set the status of the process also to realization. That could be an indicator for the business analysis that this process is now also in process. That was the first part of the demo. Now what we are doing now is decomposing the requirement into a user story or several user stories. In the demo, it will be just one. And for this, I go to the next step. Again, starting with the overview page. And why not to use again the traceability, but now for the requirement. And here I see now I have one requirement as part of my scope that is in status realization, but there is no user story and no project task yet available for that. As we are working in an agile implementation mode, I want to follow up this requirement with a user story. So I just click on the requirement. And on the right side top, we see a create button. And here, then I can choose either to create a user story or to create a project task. As mentioned, we want to work in an agile mode. So I select create a user story to follow up this requirement. I can enter a meaningful title for that user story and also a meaningful description that should now give also an indicator to the either consultant or developer what really needed to be developed or customized. And now I have also some further attributes like priority, and also I can schedule my user story with sprints. That means I can decide in which sprints this should be realized. As the sprint one is already over, I will select sprint two and assign that to sprint two. And I have also a tab additional information where I can also classify my user story regarding story points. I can assign it to a team. I can assign a role that is required to fulfill this user story. And if I know who should do it, I can even assign directly the developer who should complete the user story. What I see now here is that the user story appears now in the upcoming task card. And that is the trigger for the developer or anyone who gets a task assigned that I have to do something. If there is something on overdue, I would also see it here. But currently, that's not the case. Therefore, as a developer, I would now go to that user story, open that user story, and set it in progress. And now I skip, of course, important steps. So in parallel, now the developer needs to create a transport, which is not part of the feature functionality yet. So we cannot create a transport out of Calm. This must be done still in the managed system. And there you would create a transport, you would do your coding, and you would have a unit test, maybe in a 4i principle. And then if this is done, you would say, okay, this user story has been done. And you go back to the overview page and you see the user story has been disappeared from the upcoming task. So the next step would then be to take care about the transport that has been created during processing the user story. As the feature is quite new, we have no direct link from the user story or from the requirement yet to create that feature. So we go directly to the feature functionality and are creating a feature for the transports that we have created during the development of that requirement. So I can assign here also the scope. I also select the work stream and also adjust the priority according to the one from the user story and the requirements. And I can also provide a meaningful description. I save that. And after saving, I have the possibility to assign the relevant transport. And these are the transports that are all created and released in the managed system, and the one which is relevant for your user story could be assigned here. And you see it in the title that this fits to our user story. Therefore, I can use it. Later on, it will be that typically we can create a feature out of the user story or requirement and create a transport out of the feature. But as this is the first step for the feature in the Calm area, then we have not available this functionality. The same we see later on, we have also no traceability yet. So what is now needed? We need to deploy that transports to the QIS system. And we can set the feature to start implementation to indicate, okay, this feature is in process. And after refreshing, that could be take some time because that is done in the background with a job in the managed system, that the transports are deployed to the QIS system. And so far, the deployment to QIS was successful. So what is the next step? Next step would be, of course, we need to take care of our testing, because from the coding side and the development side, we are ready for acceptance test. And therefore, we see how the test preparation first will work in this integrated flow. So for that, we go to a card that I have not shown yet. This card also allows to go and access all the traceability features, but also, like you see here, task trend analysis. This card is the same as you would select here on the left side, this icon. But it's a quite fast navigation to this analytics overview. And in order to be able to prepare my test activities, I need to check, okay, which test need to prepared for which process. And of course, in this process traceability, I can now check, okay, which process is in realization, has a requirement that is also in realization, but doesn't have any test cases assigned yet and not prepared yet. And that could I see here in this process traceability. And to prepare the test, I go now to the test preparation application. And I say create test case, and that's a manual test case, of course. For acceptance tests, I need manual test cases because a human being need to check if the functionality is as expected and described in the requirement. Also for that test case, I assign the scope that I will see that also later on in my overview page, and assign the process as well as the process flow diagram. And that is a really cool story. With the process flow diagram, I get all the steps and activities out of the process flow into my test step and can decide which of these activities are relevant for my acceptance test. For timing reason, and also because we have just adjusted only the perform picking step, the first three activities are sufficient to do the acceptance test. For an integration test, of course, I would select all of those activities. And I set my test case to prepared and save it. Typically, I can also add here instructions and expected results in order to really validate if the test tester is doing the right things and testing in the right things, and also proves that the expected results has been met. Now I go back to the process traceability and see, okay, for this process, we have one requirement in realization. We have a test case that is prepared. And what is open now is that the test execution is still missing. Therefore, we can also directly click here also to go to the test execution overview. And I see my test case. I can directly click on execute, and I can go through all the activities that need to be validated. And if successful, I can set the steps to pass. And if everything was fine, I can also close the test run and save it. And having done the test successfully, now we can also go and deploy the transport to production. But before doing that, we need to check something, because typically you have more people involved into these activities and to this implementation process. So before you deploy, of course, you need to check if everything has been done fine. Now you see, okay, requirement is in realization, test has prepared, and test was successful. That means everything looks okay from the process side. Let's check for the requirement. Also here we see for the requirement, the user story is completed. In future, of course, you would also see as soon we can link test cases to requirements, which is on our roadmap, you would also see the test cases here in the requirements traceability, which is, of course, a very needed feature for our backlog. But you would also see that here. That means the first step that the test was successful could also be covered by this requirements traceability view. And after seeing, okay, that has been tested successfully, everything looks fine, you go back to the feature application and open that feature. You have now also the possibility together with, we have not the role yet, release manager, but it could be a quality manager or something like that, that still looks on everything like I have done now with the traceability features. And based on that, you could approve this feature for deployment. And actually then you can perform the deployment to production, which is then here done by the deploy button. And again here, there might be some time until the import has been done. So first status would be running import into S4 803, which is our production client. And after some refresh, you see, okay, it was deployed successfully. If there is any issue during the import, like a syntax error or whatever, you would also see the error here and see that something went wrong. But if everything went fine, like in our nice example, you could confirm the deployment for that feature and go back to the traceability. You can select the requirement. Also set this to deployed and also checking for the process again that everything is fine. That means the requirement is now deployed, test has been done. And finally, what I have not part of the demo is you could also set, if this was the only requirement for the process, you can also set the process to the lifecycle status in production. So that was an end-to-end demo for our requirement-driven implementation process. And yeah, Frank will now explain us that this is not just the one use case, but we have additional use cases that could be managed by Cloud ALM for implementation. So I hand over to Frank.
Thanks, Rainer, for this detailed and very complete end-to-end demo. Having a look to the time, I just take a few minutes to wrap up the whole story. It should work. Well, this is basically what Rainer showed you now, another perspective on status flow. I don't want to go into details. I just want to take that here to point out some things. On the one hand side, you see we need to switch statuses from depending to each other. For example, I need to switch a requirement to another status to be tested. once all user stories is done, as we are loosely coupled at the moment. Therefore, we use all these analytics views, which are a great help here. And also then, maybe just one thing here, our latest baby that we got, the feature, it's evolving really fast. But we see we have still some things to do, but we are also here on a really good way, because here, for example, we would need another status to see that it's to be tested. And as soon as we further think on testing, there's also then a defect that will come in the future to really complete such an end-to-end process. Now all these entities we have, requirement, user story, feature, these are all loosely coupled entities, which we control via our analytics views, and then you can build this end-to-end process that was shown by Rainer. So thinking to the future, where we will potentially get a workflow service on top, then you can think about, okay, how to also do kind of automation and putting some constraints in that you automatically switch status of different entities. But that's maybe the future we will go to. I don't want to go into more details on that, but that's definitely something that might come. And helping to have really a fully defined end-to-end process. But as we have now also all these loosely coupled entities, you have basically full flexibility. So this end-to-end process we showed you today, well, it's not the only way you can work in Focus, in Cloud ELM, sorry, just to be clear and to complete the picture. Now, I want to just show you here, on the one hand side, we have public cloud, which is this content-driven implementation. You know what you want to do, you just implement a feature and that's it. On the other hand side, we have now also private cloud offerings, where we have the possibility or customize the possibility to really build their own stuff on top to really differentiate to other customers in their process. And the process that we showed you today with the end-to-end implementation, this is more for this private cloud approach where it's really requirement driven. You have from business discussions, you get these requirements, what needs to be changed. And that's the way we see this end-to-end process. It's more for this private cloud approach where you really come with requirements, you break them down in user stories, you deliver one requirement with one feature, that's the simple case. And it really supports here also the agile implementation with sprints as shown by Rainer. Use case here, private cloud edition of S4HANA, but also if you have from our business technology platform, some development projects, this also makes sense to go such a way. Well, then another thing you can think about, if you have really bigger projects, you also go for this requirement driven approach, but you can have requirements which are too big to deliver in one feature, then it's more an incremental delivery for a requirement, and then you ship one requirement in several features. That's just more the little extension of what we showed you today. But then if you go in the direction of public cloud, for sure, there are also other valid use cases. You can have, for example, requirement-driven implementations where you don't use the user stories. You just create a requirement and then use the feature in order to deliver it. Mm-hmm. Then it's just losing this agile part of the whole story. Or another valid use case is you have something which is really user story driven. That, for example, in an Ariba use case, you have predefined user stories that you know, okay, these are the things you can do. You just pick and choose the user story and then you deliver it via the feature, which is also a thing. Or finally, removing all the other stuff, also feature leading makes sense in certain cases. For example, if you really have a feature-driven implementation in public cloud or pure cloud deployments, it makes sense maybe that to the process to process documentation, you just assign a feature and directly deliver this with a feature. It's just giving you this overview here it's not this end-to-end process the only thing you can do, and for sure there are many other, or these are the other use cases you can also do with all the entities we currently have. And as we really deliver every second week we get new features in Cloud ALM. You will see also for our end-to-end process that we showed you today that it's really evolving over the next months, and it's really then getting a complete story. Okay, so said that, we are close to the end, and I would just open for Q&A.
We have some questions in the chat. For example, Daniel would like to know, when can we use this E2E use cases, which was shown also for S4HANA on-prem implementations? That would be the use case we need for now.
I think you can already start now. So basically,
go ahead. So what you have seen is already available in the productive Calm environment. And of course, what I have shown is we still have some, not gaps, but to use it really in a larger project, we need some further filter attributes, for instance, for the traceability that you really see from the semantic point of view, which requirements are in a certain state and could be then start the implementation via user stories and so on. What we expect, and that is the answer also in the keynote on Tuesday, was that next year, most likely first half of the year, I think it could be used really for either S4 private cloud edition or on-premise. But as you can, if you are entitled to have Cloud ALM, you can also check if this is what you need. So that's quite easy. But it's available, as what I showed is available so far in production.
We have some more questions. I would say we talk about these questions in the Media Expert session in the afternoon today.
Then you will take that with you, Melanie?
I take them with me, yes, of course.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah, it fits even to the solution manager.
Okay, thank you.
George, thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks for your interest. Having a nice day. Bye.